This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust, the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get any further, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So before we get into the news, Jay, how are you doing? It's been like 2 weeks since you and I talked.
I know. doing well. Things have gotten a little expanded at the household here lately. We have a new addition to the family. We recently adopted a brand new 8-week-old golden retriever puppy, and we named her Leia.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. Well, it was funny because I put out a little Twitter poll because I was kind of, you know, going back and forth between Xana, Zori, Leia, you know, a whole bunch of or other. And so I thought, you know what? I'm going to go with Leia because one, it just feels right. And two, I can find a whole lot of stuff with Princess Leia on it, I feel like. And, there's really not much Darth Xana stuff out there. So.
Well, they were all great names. No doubt. You couldn't go wrong with any of them that you would have picked. I'm partial Xana, so that was my vote. Like I said, I mean, how can you go wrong with Leia? Like, you know, that's a great name. You picked three great Star Wars names, and I've seen all the pictures on Instagram, and she's absolutely adorable, and loved watching her play with her big brother. And so that was, it's been fun to see those pictures online. That's been great that you've been sharing them.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. Big adjustment, but, you know, always is when you have a new baby.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, because I don't think it's been 2 weeks since you and I have actually talked to each other. We've texted a little bit over the past week or so, but I don't think we've gone 2 weeks without talking to each other since we started Podcast Stardust. So
yes,
this has been a little unusual. We've had some stories, and but let's get into it. And there's a rather different type of Star Wars news. I feel like I'm saying that a lot lately, but no 2 weeks are the same, of course. And the biggest news came out last week while you were gone. And we'll touch on that because I want to get your take on a few things. But first off, it wasn't the busiest news week. But, you know, John Boyega was recently on Instagram and he shared a picture of himself back on the set because he's starting to film a new movie. I'm not even sure what it was. And part of the conversation he was having with his followers was about his future involvement in Star Wars. And one follower said, "Force Finn in action with a green lightsaber dressed in black is all I want from the next Star Wars film." But John Boyega responded to that with, "LOL, no thank you, I've moved on," with a heart emoji. Mm-hmm. And then another user followed that up with, "I really just got those Disney bucks and dipped," and then with a laughing crying emoji, to which John responded, "No, not into playing one role for too long. I have more to offer than that. That's all." So what do you think about John telling the fandom that he's kind of put Star Wars behind him?
Okay, social media, first of all, you know, you kind of have to take it for a grain of salt. And God love John Boyega because he's been so wonderful with the fans overall. And you know what? The guy has every right to say he's moving on. Just because he's, you know, been in Star Wars doesn't mean that he's dipped into the Disney pot or whatever. I mean, heck yeah. I mean, yeah, you want to be able to make your mark on something, and what better way to do that than Star Wars? But if he's offered other roles and he's willing to move on, and he's his heart is where he wants it to be, and his career is going where he wants it to go, why not? I mean, I have nothing but love for the guy and hope for the best for him. And I got to say, it was cool to see this picture of him in all of his protective PPE gear, because that just tells me that there is filming, there is stuff going on that is going to be produced and put out there for fans of any kind. So I'm encouraged by that. But anyways, that was my blabbering response. What about you?
I'm with you on that 100%. And never say never. There was a time when no one ever thought Harrison Ford would come back to Star Wars, when the public perception was that he hated Han Solo, that character, and that he wanted him killed off in Return of the Jedi, and then he was never come back to Star Wars. But he did. He came, and not once, but twice. He showed up in Rise of Skywalker as well. So never say never. Who knows what will happen in 10 years if they ever get around to coming up with a new set of movies that builds off of Rey, Poe, and Finn's adventures. Similar thing just happened not too long ago with Oscar Isaac. And when he was doing the promotional rounds for The Rise of Skywalker, and he was asked if he would do some sort of a continuing adventures of Poe Dameron, he said no, he was cashing in his chips. And someone brought up the idea of, well, you know, what if there's a Disney Plus series? And you know, he said that it wasn't really his bag, but he didn't close the door on it. And a Star Wars investment as an actor can really take up a lot of your time. That's the majority of your time to make movies, especially when a trilogy is involved, for 6, 7, 8 years. And that doesn't give you an opportunity to really exercise your acting chops in other areas. And I could see wanting to do something else besides that same character for so long a period of time. But I would just encourage your fans to exercise some caution, exercise some restraint and some understanding on that. And who knows, there might be some other role of a lifetime out there that John has in mind that he'd like to do. And at some point, someone may show him a script for a Star Wars movie in the future that he can't say no to, and he'd be back. These things aren't ever etched in stone. They can change.
Right. And especially in the world of entertainment, because like you said, you just never know. But, you know, just be like saying to someone that, you know, okay, I've done this particular job and now I'm ready to move on in the world and experience different careers. Who expects somebody to stay in a career if they're not, you know, ready to do that? I mean, if you want to expand your horizons and if you want to go work somewhere else, then you go work somewhere else. So I don't know why acting has to be any different. But sometimes I think fans tend to pigeonhole certain actors in certain roles and they just can't imagine them in anything else. But, you know, think about Will Smith, for example. I mean, he's been in a bazillion different types of roles and nobody has a problem with that. So,
right. Yeah. And there's such a thing as typecasting, and actors have to guard against that. And if he keeps playing Finn, then the roles he gets pitched are going to be Finn or Finn adjacent and stuff. So I could see why he might want to expand what it is that he's doing out there. And I don't blame him for that at all. And you know, you're only this age for so long. Take advantage of the different roles that come your way. If there's something, it sounds like something you want to do, grow your career. And I don't blame him at all. And quite frankly, I don't believe this is the last what we'll see of him in Star Wars, but it may be a while before we see him there again. Huh? All right. Well, moving on. Last week, we had the news break that the next, or an upcoming series, I should say, animated series for Star Wars is The Bad Batch. And I got to talk to Joe when he filled in for you last week on the news about this quite a bit. But I really wanted to get your take, Jay. What did you think about the news of The Bad Batch coming to Disney Plus in 2021?
Well, I have to say, first of all, that I really enjoyed the discussion that you and Joe had. And so when I first saw the announcement of this, I smiled from ear to ear and I just thought, yes, yes, we're getting it. We're getting it. Because I know you and I, we've talked about this, that if there was ever anything that we wanted to see spin off or more stories that we would want, that The Bad Batch would be a great one to see some of those. So I was super excited about this. And as soon as I found out about it, I let my son know about it and he was really excited about it. So yeah, but I loved what Joe said about this almost sounding like the Star Wars A-Team. I thought that was a really great analogy. So yeah, I mean, super duper exciting. It really is. I can't say enough about it.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. I was really excited to hear it. And I know I said this last week, but I'm just repeating myself. Because when you and I were recording our reviews of those episodes of Season 7 of The Clone Wars, I remember we had the conversation, where have these guys been the entire time? Why couldn't we have had more of their stories? And that's not taking anything from Rex or Commander Cody or some of our other favorite clones that showed up over the course of The Clone Wars, but they were just a little bit more different. They were a little bit more unique, and it was just another angle on The Clone Wars that we didn't have. And I would love to have seen more of them. But they introduced them in the first arc of the final season. I mean, it was one third of the final season. So, wow, that's when we get them. And now they're gone forever. So I was extremely delighted to see that they were going to be back. And I'm very excited to see what their future adventures will be. But along those lines, Sam Witwer, Darth Maul himself, has had an opportunity to comment on The Bad Batch. And this was during a Twitch interview or discussion he was having. And the comments he made, the first was about the setting, which was, I will tell you, it looks really, really good. It looks absolutely beautiful. The story, at least I know where the story begins for the first several episodes. And I was very pleased because it's a little area of Star Wars that has not often been visited. Talk about intriguing. I have no idea what that means.
Right. But so my brain is going wild because could it be right after Order 66? You know, when we don't get a whole lot of really expansion on some storylines in there. And then, you know, we've talked before too about, did they have inhibitor chips? You know, now that Fives is with them, could he have maybe taught them how to take it out? I mean, my brain is just going all over the place with this.
Yeah. And I'm going to bring up the other quote here, and then I have some other questions to follow about it. But as far as the animation style, which is something Joe and I were talking about last week, Sam had to say this. It meant getting a lot of people back in there that was previously been at Lucasfilm. I think he used the wrong tense there, so I'm going to restate it. It meant getting a lot of people back that had previously been at Lucasfilm and moved on when Clone Wars was canceled. In order to do Clone Wars, you need a lot of those folks back. What I liked is that they didn't just put all that back together only to let them go again. So what I saw was brilliant, extraordinarily beautiful, beautiful, beautiful animation. I won't say what it looks like, but I will say this. Of the quality of Clone Wars, where that bar is set, yes, absolutely, totally. So that was amazing to hear.
Yeah, to say the least. So what's your take on it?
My take on it was that it's not going to be the exact same thing as Clone Wars, but it's going to at least be of that quality.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How about you?
So I'm thinking that, you know, we've gotten a lot of this mocap with Lauren Mary Kim and with, why can't I think of his name? Ray Park, with doing Darth Maul. So, you know, what if they're doing a lot more mocap and then putting it into the animation style of the original Clone Wars? Because how fluid was everything from start to finish in the new season of the Clone Wars? I mean, we talked about this over and over and over again in terms of even just the small little nuances of even hair blowing in the wind, you know, in the way that people were moving and whatnot. So I'm wondering if there's going to be more of that and, you know, maybe more of the background assets kind of being more embellished, I guess you could say, than they were in the past.
I really don't know. I mean, when it comes down to it, what's interesting about the motion capture that they did for the Clone Wars is that, having watched those episodes a couple times now, there is a distinct difference between the motion capture aspects of that Maul-Ahsoka fight compared to other areas of that series, even that same season. There is a different Maul moves differently, Ahsoka moves differently, and it's fantastic. It looks very realistic. And especially when you looked at kind of like some of the making of when it comes to that scene that they had on StarWars.com, whatever, you can see what they did and how well it worked. And I really, really, really loved it. I don't know if there's as much of a need for that when it comes to The Bad Batch, because although they had some, especially Hunter, had some very physical confrontations and Rucker with the way things that he did, it wasn't a lot of, the climax was not necessarily them going hand to hand with like the big bad in the episode. So I don't know that as much as that's a need, but it's an asset and it should definitely be incorporated where it is appropriate. I'm still inferring here from what Witwer said that we're talking about a slightly different animation style. Personally, I prefer them keeping something that looks like the Clone Wars or a hybrid between the Clone Wars and Rebels rather than the Resistance model.
Mm-hmm.
The three different styles of animation we had, Resistance wasn't bad. It just was not my favorite of the three.
I would totally agree with you on that one. And like you said, Resistance wasn't bad, but it wasn't to the movie or theatrical caliber that this last season, especially of the Clone Wars, was. And like you said, if you hybrid that with Rebels, kind of the best of both worlds.
Yeah, definitely. Resistance was much more, it almost looked kind of like a bit of washed out is a bit, because it wasn't as 3D. They used computer generated technology to get that show out, and they did a good job, but mm-hmm. there wasn't as much features on each character's face.
Right. Right.
Or
it's almost borderline anime in some ways, not true anime, but yeah.
Well, and Clone Wars was described as like 3D anime when it came out, which was not entirely accurate either, but it was, you know, they came up with their own styles for each one of these shows, and I've enjoyed them all for different reasons. And so I'm really eager to see what this show looks like. And as much as I can second guess based on these offhand comments that we get from various sources on social media, they haven't ever really disappointed me with what they've chosen to do. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt, and they haven't given me a reason not to do so.
Oh, absolutely. And we're getting more Clone Wars content. We're mm-hmm. getting Bad Batch. We're getting more Star Wars, and that's always a good thing.
So do you have a wish list for the show of anything that's going to happen?
Gosh, I really haven't taken the time to think about it just yet. I mean, I'm just still kind of wrapping my head around the whole idea that it's happening, and I'm just so excited for it. And just like I said, just happy that we're getting more Star Wars on the way. So I'm going to have to think about that. Meditate on this. I will. How about you?
Not so much. But here's my follow-up question to that. What do you think Sam Witwer's role is in the show? There's no announcement that he has a role, but I kind of feel like if he's been shown stuff, it could have been because Dave Filoni or somewhere along the line like Sam, and they just decided to let him in on the secret. But he's a talented voice actor. I kind of feel like he's probably got a role in this somewhere.
Oh, he is indeed, and he can fabricate his voice into just about anything. I mean, just, of course, watching him as Darth Maul, but I always enjoyed him. Did you ever watch the ABC series Once Upon a Time?
I've seen a little bit, but not much.
Oh, man. Well, he did a stint as Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde in that. Wow. And he was incredible with the way that he could just turn on a dime, and his whole personality and demeanor and voice style and everything. So whatever he's involved with, in whatever capacity, he's bringing that talent, and I think that that's a blessing.
Yeah, I agree, because he's done Darth Maul, he's done the brother, he did Starkiller in the Force Unleashed games, he's done the Emperor's voice, he's got range, he can do a lot of things. I could see Maul showing up in this show. I could also see Witwer doing any number of other type of characters in that as well. He's got talent. He can do it. So, mm-hmm. Well, here's a rumor that I'm including in our news simply because I know you as my co-host. but of course, and I know you're no stranger to this, but the big rumor is right now that Hayden Christensen has been cast as Anakin Skywalker in the upcoming Kenobi Disney Plus live action show. And you texted me to ask if this was true. I when you heard about it, and all I could tell is, well, that's the rumor. But and I know what your reaction to this, but go ahead and tell the listeners is what you're thinking about all this.
Well, first of all, I just have to say, I love how you constantly cater to my Anakin Skywalker / Hayden Christensen needs, because this this is something that, of course, I'm very excited about. But I was reading this article that you have in our notes here from Jedi News, and it talks about how his role is said, to be reprised for the upcoming Disney Plus Kenobi series, and that it was supposed to have been a done deal and then announced at Star Wars Celebration. So, now that we've got that on hiatus until 2022, yeah, this is just so great to hear. But I just thought it was interesting because they said that he was supposed to have started as a cameo appearance, kind of as a possible even dream sequence or flashback sequence, because of where the whole Kenobi series was supposed to have been set. But I thought it was very interesting in the article how they said, but because of the love that has been, the growing love of the prequel trilogy, I think is how it was worded, and the popularity of the Clone Wars, the role of Anakin has become a bigger part of the Kenobi storyline. So I had to full stop right here. the growing love of the prequel trilogy. Mm-hmm. I just had to giggle at that because, of course, you know, the prequels have been under fire for so long, and I'm glad to see the pendulum swinging back the other way. Don't get me wrong, but I did have to giggle at that just a little bit.
I'm with you there. This is a story that, I am willing to give the benefit of the doubt to the creatives over at Lucasfilm because I don't feel like they've ever really steered me wrong. I mean, The Mandalorian has been so awesome, and as many of the rumors that you and I have talked about on this show over the past few months, as far as casting goes for season two, at sometimes I found myself rolling my eyes like, really? That's what's going to happen? This second season of The Mandalorian is so overpacked with cameos and appearances by well-known characters. Like, I don't know how they're going to pull it off, but I trust, if it's true, I trust Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni and those types to pull it off. This would be cool if Hayden Christensen was involved. And I would love to see him get back into Star Wars. I feel like he was so underappreciated for a long time. The way that line you were quoting about him, you know, this growing love of the prequels, etc. Maybe I'm just being critical of the reporting. In fact, I am being critical of the reporting. That is a weird thing to put in an article, that's the reason, without quoting somebody about it. Put the guy in the show because he belongs in the show, and it makes something, it enhances the show. It is, I guess, is my response to that. I'd love to see more of Hayden Christensen in there. I'm now second guessing what Kenobi is going to be about, because we've been told it's this the series that takes place between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope, like 8-10 years later, and Kenobi's on Tatooine and he's looking after a young Luke Skywalker. But if Anakin is going to play that great role in it, are we talking maybe towards the end of the Clone Wars, where he's going to be in it? Or is Hayden going to be playing Darth Vader, not necessarily Anakin Skywalker, or what's going on? It's just it's just very odd. This is a rumor that I would enjoy if it was true, but I'm having a very hard time taking it seriously.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I can totally see that for sure, because I want this so bad, of course, because Ewan and Hayden, they've just always had such great on-screen chemistry as Obi-Wan and Anakin anyways. And to see them reprise their roles on the series would just really be a dream come true. So I've been thinking a lot too, as far as what you said with the timeline and, you know, could it be at the end of Clone Wars? But like you said, it's supposed to have been set between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope. But wouldn't it be kind of cool? And of course, this is my wish list. You talk about, do I have a wish list? For this one, I would like to see, and you mentioned Hayden doing Vader or acting as Vader, seeing him without the mask every once in a while and seeing him struggle with his transition to becoming Vader as well. And there was that one novel by Matthew Stover, I believe it was Dark Lord, if I'm not mistaken, where there was a lot of that inner dialogue that was going on with Anakin / Vader at the time. And I think that would be amazing to bring some of that in.
Yeah. Dark Lord, the Rise of Darth Vader was actually written by James Luceno.
James Luceno. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry, James.
No worries. I'm sure he's fine with that. I guess for me is this, I don't have a problem if they want to do the flashback thing between The Rise of Skywalker and The Last Jedi. We didn't have like flashbacks before then, but then we've had two movies where, and then even with The Force Awakens, there was a bit of a flashback with Rey's vision. Flashbacks are now a thing in Star Wars, and The Mandalorians had them as well. So they can do them in Star Wars. So it didn't used to be a thing, but now it is. And if they want to do as part of the storytelling thing where maybe Kenobi's on some sort of adventure and something similar to an adventure he had with Anakin in the past, that he flashes back to that, and there's some lesson that was learned there that ties into the current adventure, then that's fine. Did you ever watch the show Psych by any chance?
No, I have not. I've heard some good things though.
Yeah, it was canceled years ago. They've done two movies since then. The launch of the Peacock Network recently had a new Psych movie on it, which my family and I just watched last Friday and really enjoyed. But those shows traditionally started off with one of the main characters, Sean. There was a kind of a flashback with him as a kid learning a lesson from his father, who was a police officer at the time, and then that lesson getting applied to whatever the current mystery was. It was a comedy more than anything else, a comedy / mystery. And so I could kind of see something like that, that Kenobi is, whatever he's dealing with in the current episode, he has a flashback to whatever reminds him of it with Anakin, or there was something that he learned while training Anakin or having Anakin alongside that is informative of how he handles the current situation. I could see them doing something like that, and that would make sense, and they could do it very well. But just the reporting on this, I think by itself is a little convoluted, is what's making me second guess it, because I trust the creatives involved. If this is what they're going to do it well, it's just that the way it's being reported is making me second guess it.
Yeah, I can totally see that. And all we can do is just keep our fingers crossed and hope for the best. And of course, Deborah Chow is the front runner for directing the Kenobi Plus series too. And she did a great job on The Mandalorian. So I was just trying to think of how some of the episodes she did, I think, what was it? Episode 3, The Sin of The Mandalorian. Mm-hmm. And so just that was one of my favorite episodes in the entire series. So if she brings any of that kind of energy, which I know she will, into this and puts Anakin into that as well, I can just hope for the best. I mean, that's all we can do.
Oh, yeah. Episode 3 might be my favorite episode of that series. And she did an amazing job with that. And I remember seeing on the gallery when they were talking to her when they did that episode about the directors and her talking about how much she enjoys action. I was like, oh, this makes me so much more excited for Kenobi than I was before. So, all right. Well, that kind of brings us to the end of our discussion of this week's Star Wars news. And we want to thank you all for listening to this episode of Podcast Stardust. And furthermore, we'd like to remind you that Podcast Stardust is part of the Retrozap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of our show over on retrozap.com. You can, of course, subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcast, including the Retrozap Podcast feed. If you've enjoyed the show, there are a few things you can do to help us grow. First, spread the word about Podcast Stardust on social media and make sure to tag us when you do. Also, please consider heading over to Apple Podcasts and leaving us a 5-star rating and a brief review about what it is that you like about the show. With that being said, Jay, can you tell everyone where they might find us on social media?
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. If you want to connect with Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest page, and we have a YouTube channel where you can check out all of our past episodes and current, as well as our unboxing videos. And you can email us at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. What do you think of this week's news? We'd love to know. And if email's just not your thing, you can also come hang out with us on Discord. We are just one of many, many shows that have their own rooms on the Discord server. And there's just some general rooms over there, too, that you can just chat everything geeky. So it's just a lot of fun. So go to our community tab on our show page, and it'll take you right where you need to go. And last but not least, you can also support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can find everything from t-shirts, sweatshirts, and coffee mugs and stickers, and you name it, it's over there. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all of those great show logo designs for us.
Okay, well, that'll do it for episode 130 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone, and until next time, may the Force be with you.